and I say, exciting! Alright dear friends, today we are going to talk about the Ming Dynasty again. Before, we talked about the Ming Dynasty from the political view and the military view as a start of the dynasty. The start of the dynasty had two sides. The one side was the military side. The second side was the personal development of the emperor as a spiritual being. And this part we're going to talk about today. The spiritual side of the emperor is the side that was responsible for the development of the Wudang Pai, Wudang Xuan Wu Pai especially. And it is important to understand their views on health and vitality and immortality in respect to what the Chu emperor thought. Start. We're talking in the earlier video about the Ming Dynasty, about the founding of the Ming Dynasty, and we've shown how Emperor Chu actually is more or less the founding father, founding principle of modern Kung Fu schools, in the sense of how he built a private army, and with his private army he conquered his reality, and how he did that and why he did it and so on. We touched a little bit on the spiritual side by showing that he was originally part of the Red Turban sect. I wanted to make a video about his son, because, no, actually another member of the family, because that one is very important for the reputation of Sun Wukong. On my way to doing that, doing some research before I started, I ran into a few issues about the way how he conquered his empire, and they refer to the way how the emperor was thinking, and also how he developed spirituality. And because of his spiritual development, he created a particular kind of empire where he has a lens of the between heaven and earth on the one side and humanity on the other side, had particular kind of ideas. And this is basically, you know, what we're getting into today. And I promise you it's going to be very interesting. And it touches on some of my own experiences, because when I was in Wudang in the beginning, everything related to what I'm going to talk about now was considered Misin because of the influence of the Chinese government. Misin is superstition. In fact, it is the heartland of Wudang Taoism. And at this moment still, a lot of these things are not being told or thought, especially to Western brothers and sisters who are studying in the Wudang Mountains. So this form of spirituality, of course, is very important for the realization of their Taoism, which is rooted in, well, Ming thinking. And Ming thinking starts with the thinking of the emperor, and movements like Neo-Confucianism and so forth, they all fit it in within the idea of what the emperor was thinking. And you will figure out some of the details of what they have told you at your Kung Fu school or your Taoist monastery or whatever you are studying in Wudang or related to Wudang. You will find some of these details back in this story, but then with their actual historical connotations. So that's really very, well, what can I say? Exciting! Ming Dynasty brought a couple of new developments. And we already saw that a little bit in a previous video, because the emperor was from a peasant origin, and that was completely new. So he brought a completely different kind of worldview with him. And there's a few things about this side, and we haven't discussed that, so we're going to make sure we're going to discuss that now, because it is actually very important for the founding and the development of the Ming Dynasty, and also for Wudang culture and establishment of Zhen Wu as the god of Wudang. And you will see further on in this series how that actually works. Because that is the reason why I make these videos, is to make sure that there is like a visible history of Wudang history and how it relates to what people learn at this moment there and how it is supposed to be done. And it also fits in with my book about Wudang that I still have to finish writing. Okay, good. Chu Yuanqiang, as you know, is the name of the founder of the Ming Dynasty. He had a side to him that is rarely discussed by the communist leaders, who took him as an example for a worker who became emperor and who saw Chu as a model to root the communist party on and their philosophy on, as an example of how workers can become emperors. And it is very interesting because he is also associating himself with the color red for his dynasty, and the communist party sees himself sees itself as an extension of that color. Also, they also use red for their dynasty, of course, because communism, the color is red. So this is a nice story. Our story starts actually with the grandfather of Chu, because his grandfather was what we would call nowadays a shaman. And in case you think you know what is a shaman, there are so many different kinds of shamans. It is very difficult to comprehend what it actually means. But shamanism is an essential part of Siberian culture, and there is particular forms in China, Mongolia, Korea, and Vietnam also to a particular kind of degree. And in China, this form of Shaoism is called Wujiao, which is usually translated by Westerners as Wuism. And Wuism is not exactly true as a translation, because Wujiao actually means teachings of the Wu. In Western sources, we also call it sometimes witchcraft. There's many textbooks who call Wuism witchcraft. And the oldest roots of Wuism is in already Neolithic times. And maybe you've seen from my video on the classes in Portugal, I really love things that go back to Neolithic times, and I like teaching in Portugal because of this root in Neolithic times, because also Taoism, as an extension of both Confucianism and Wuism, roots back to the same Neolithic times. Modern North Korea actually still uses Wuist ideas to legitimize the power of the Kims, because they believe that a particular mountain, which used to be at the middle of Korea but is now at the borderland between North Korea and China, that this is the home of a particular kind of mountain god which provides the power of the Kims and many kings and emperors in the past from Korea. And they are descended from that, and they are symbolized by a bear, if I remember well. I have to ask my wife if she knows this. Actually, she doesn't really know so much about Korean culture.
Maybe I should not tell that to anybody, because then I can't use her as an authority. Okay, we go.
Local shamanism in China, they are still of an influence today. So there are still shamans. It is not as popular and as large as is Taoism or Buddhism. Buddhism is even much bigger than Taoism. They also influenced Taoist rituals to a large degree. Shamanism and Wuism, they developed for a large part around the idea of long life. So you know, you understand which brand or which side of Taoism plays a role in that. That's the long life ideas. They're basically based on a worldview which is essentially shamanic, in that people overcome the entities and powers of nature to eventually become an essential part of nature itself. And although that is a major part of Taoism, we will see in the Ming Dynasty that the emperor actually had mixed feelings about this. And also, what is important as a root for Taoism is that the Xian, the mountain man, actually originally was the mountain shaman. And they are often seen as the Taoists who retreat in the mountains and do their own weird practices, like I also incorporated in the extensive Daoland program, and especially the more psychological trainings of the internal body to put on all kinds of chemical switches. like communication with inner spirits and stuff, internal spirits and so on. These are originally from these kind of strands of thoughts. And you see in Taoist revelations very often coming back strands like this at the same time. The emperor drew for his religious and spiritual inspiration from both Buddhism, Taoism, Confucianism, and also Manichaeism. And Manichaeism I already discussed in the past, and I will shortly summarize all four so that you have a little bit of an idea as a remembrance for what these are. Because Buddhism focuses on the belief that the reality isn't really true. So the reality that we see is not really true, but the Buddha mind or Buddha nature is. So people seek enlightenment in the hope that they find their true Buddha nature, and then basically they become a Buddha. And that might be the Buddha that is already existing, or a part or an aspect of a Buddha or something like this, but that doesn't really matter that much. There are some Platonic overtones in there which are very interesting, but that's another story. Taoism focuses on the belief that reality is real, and that failing to blend into reality causes you to get sick and die eventually. So when you blend in properly, and that can be done on all kind of different kind of ways, then as a result of blending in, you would have a long life and you become part of reality as a whole. And that can mean that you become a god or something like this. In the same way, if you behave very evil, you can become a demon. It is part of the idea why Taoists seek a long life, and we get back to that later too. Confucianism didn't exclude the natural world, but scholars see Confucianism often as a form of pseudo-secularism, as if they precluded secularism in the West, which is a form of humanism, which is aiming to be non-Christian and non-religious in a way to provide safety, security and well-being for all beings without requiring a god as an intervening or a law-giving power. So this is not exactly correct, but this is how people usually see. But Confucianism pays a lot of attention to the role of people in society. You'll find later in the story how important that is. One's role in society is essential for the state, but it is also essential for your relationship with your family members. And knowing what is your role and behaving according to these roles is an essential part that is what this Confucian teachings are showing. You should think in your daily life according to Confucius. Who should affect your life more, like your parents or the state? And you see in schools nowadays also that schools are often very often they are organized by your religion or by your state or by social groups, like the project that we are working at in Portugal. Sometimes people give home education because they want to be in full control over their child and what is going on in their minds. In all cases, education, of course, is brainwashing. Manichaeism is a little bit different. It is not originally Chinese, less so even than Buddhism. And it is basically about the struggle between good and evil, light and dark. And this is a very important aspect of the religions and the sects, like the White Lotus Society and the Red Turbans, that are so essential in the forming of the Ming Dynasty and the formation of the thoughts and feelings and the political career and the military career of Chu. Fact anyway is that Chu as a peasant child was raised in a world of ghosts, spirits, portents, magic and so forth and so forth. And these things are nowadays called superstition or misen. Part of his rise was the membership of a Manichaeist sect, which we call the Red Turban sect. The Red Turban sect also incorporated elements of Taoism, Buddhism, Confucianism, and Christianity was not there yet. Islam was not really there yet. But it took from any kind of belief structure that it came across. It took people in and took some of their ideas, and they created a sort of eclectic idea about spirituality, and we'll get back to that in a later time also. What they did, the Red Turbans, they followed what is called Ming Jiao, what they called Ming Jiao. This is the teachings of brightness, that is Manichaeism in Chinese. So now you understand where the Ming Dynasty gets its name for. It's a Manichaeistic idea, and we said in the previous video that Confucius advised him to not associate too closely with the white turbans, but he did keep some of the belief elements, and he gave his dynasty the name of this thing. This Manichaeism originated from Persia, so that's a foreign religion, and it entered China during the Tang Dynasty, where it gave birth to the White Lotus Society, which also rebelled against the Tang, against the Song, and against the Yuan. But gradually over the ages they lost power, and the Red Turbans basically took over that power, and they also absorbed elements of the White Lotus Society. Many, and also many followers of the White Lotus Society, became part of the Red Turban rebellion. And also Maitreya followers, that's a brand of Buddhism that are seeking salvation for the end of the world, they also went in. So the Red Turbans also had an idea about salvation. Not necessarily the end of the world, but salvation especially. And the Prince of Brightness, the Prince of Light, was supposed to bring that salvation. So the name choosing of Chu as the Prince Ming, Prince of Ming, and the dynasty of Ming is actually based on his roots in this Red Turban religion. And it played a major role in the success of his dynasty, for the startup of his dynasty, of course. The literati, or the Ru, they rooted to a large degree back to the Song dynastic thinker Shu Xi, who lives from 1130 to 1200. And he certainly was an influence on Wudang culture, and you'll find it back in my book, but then especially about his earlier years as a Confucianist, because at that moment he experimented with Buddhist and Taoist meditations, and he had the idea that you should also be able to implement meditation and its effects in movement, which was at that moment not something that anybody done. And you see Buddhists like Thich Nhat Hanh, also the way how he exercises, although he claims that it goes back to Buddhist sutras to prepare you for actual Buddhist meditation. You see that the most old descriptions of movement meditation is from Shu Xi. The problem is, though, that other Confucians, they thought, like, you know, you're a Confucian, you're a Ru, you shouldn't meditate, you should just pay attention to the details of life. And from a modern perspective, you can say, well, actually, that is already meditation also. He became later in his life a very sectarian Confucianist, and he had the idea that reality didn't have space for ghosts and portents and stuff like this, although it might feel like that sometimes. But he said it is as a result of natural forces that are moving around you, the qi and so on, and they can make you feel like as if there is ghosts and spirits and stuff like this. And the emperor chose sides against that view, because he believed very seriously in ghosts and spirits and portents and immortals. In the contributing article, you'll find more details on this, to make sure that I don't go too far in my story, because there's a lot of the different kind of details on this story. Chu, as an emperor, believed that gods, spirits, ghosts and so on, they can intervene in human lives through dreams, physical appearances, but also in the form of revelation through natural phenomena. So he basically turned it around, what Shu Xi said. He said, like, okay, the ghosts and spirits can create natural phenomena. And I was with a ritual in Chengdu to open Taoism as a world religion, and to make it into a popular religion. That was the idea, to compete with Buddhism, Christianity and Islam as the oldest Chinese religion. And there was like this huge flags hanging at the gate of Qingchenshan, and they were doing a ritual, and then there was a particular kind of movement of the flags, and then they said, like, look, this is a portent, and it makes the qi move, the ghosts and the gods, they make the qi move, so that we know, like, okay, we're going to be successful in what we are doing. That was, of course, very interesting, and at that moment I was like, well, you know, it could also be the wind, because, of course, it's healthy to be a skeptic. But, you know, you don't really know. The thing is with ghosts and spirits and stuff like this is that you can only see them through their influences, and then you can deduce, according to your worldview, if it is a natural phenomena or if it is a ghost or a spirit. And in both cases, you will be right because you believe you will be right. And the truth of it can never really be known. And the truth of a lot of things, of course, cannot really be known. And that's part of the strength, that's the mystery of reality. He believed further that the gods, they serve as a mirror for humanity. So that means the qualities that they represent, and I believe in that too, actually, is what people are lacking. So they're mirroring people and show, like, look, this is your problem, this is basically your problem, and the worship of gods is to help you undo your problems. That's part of Taoist training anyway, to get into an understanding of your errors and your mistakes, and to eventually overcome them so that you become a better person. As a person, you have to do fasting of the heart, and the Chu Emperor also believed in that, and it's essential for Wudang culture also. And the fasting of the heart is emptying the heart, taking the heat out of your heart, and cleaning your heart and polishing. That is something that in all Taoist meditation techniques plays a role as a preparation, so that your heart becomes like a mirror. And that the character Xin is also written as a mirror with dirt specks coming into it, and you will see it here or there, or both places. And at the moment your mirror is clear because of fasting, you can see reality as it is, at least that's the idea of it. And that is also why we meditate in the way how we do. And there are several ways, of course, to clean the heart properly, and we will get to a lot of these details also in the Zhong Wuqigong classes. This process is called fasting the mind, or fasting the heart, so that the heart becomes empty and emptier, and it's also called stilling the heart, so that there's no movement in the heart, and the more clear it becomes, the more clear you can see the reflection of things that are happening. And this is basically what cults also do. They mirror you in a very clear way, and they help you in that sense when you associate yourself with gods, to redeem yourself. And that's not always through the easiest way, as I have learned over the years in the rituals and ceremonies that I had to do for Chengwu, where actually when I thought, like, okay, please deliver me of this, then things only became more difficult. And this is in general like that. Also in magic, it's the same. You do something, you perform magic for somebody else, there's always something coming back to you, and usually that what is coming back to you is making life more difficult for you, because you interconnect yourself with the life of somebody you do magic for. And this is part of the spiritual reality that you involve yourself in if you open yourself up to these kind of belief systems. And this is what the Chu Emperor did, but he limited himself to ceremonies, meditation, reading sacred texts, and so forth and so forth, to make sure that he would not be overcome by all the other things that might take care. And that is something that he got from Confucianism, because Confucianism basically holds on to ritualization of life for the sake of avoiding that there is a backlash as a result of what you're doing. So this is a nice thing. And as a result of that, Chu placed an importance to performing all kind of sacrifices, and he had all kind of sacrifice that he did. And there's one story where he sit for 3 days out in the rain out in the sun because it was not raining, and he wanted the rain to come to help the farmers from the country and so on and so forth. And he, after 3 days, they said, like, you know, it's getting crazy, and his courtiers, they forced him to go back inside, and he meditated 2 more days before it actually started raining. So he was all the time sitting there performing sacrifice. He sacrificed himself as such. The thing is that sacrifice provides purity in your communication with gods and spirits. It also empties your bowels. And the more your bowels are empty, the stronger the dantian becomes. That's also one of the reasons why in the Daoland program I always emphasize don't eat too much. Because if you eat too much, there will not be a dantian developing. It doesn't matter if you are very big in your body. That can come about for many different kind of reasons. But the bowels itself, they should be as empty as possible, because there has to be a particular kind of cleanliness for your kidneys and your intestines to develop a dantian. And it shouldn't mean that you shouldn't eat at all, although there's people who practice these kind of things too. But that is, for most people, that's just way out of their... just shouldn't do it. I mean, if you live in the mountains as a Xian, that is another thing. Then maybe you have time for it. In the text, when I write down the whole text and I have all the corrections done, you'll read a little bit more about this part, but it's an important part. What we take in the idea of medicine from the ideas of Taoist medicine, basically, in as far as it goes to the worldview of the Ming Dynasty, this purity of intent, then the freedom of sin is also very good. And the freedom of sin, I added something to the video about sin. I advise you to go watch it. The link is below also. And have a look at it so that you can see what is the difference between sin in Chinese culture and Christian culture. The difference actually is really very meaningful. And Chu writes all kind of articles. And he writes one of the things that what discerns the sage from the robber is the movement of the spirit, which can happen because of your purity. If you're not pure, there's no movement of the shun. This is called shen yun, and yun is also the same yun as from yun dong, the sports. This in turn depends on developments of one's shunling. Shunling meditation we do as part of the Zhong Wuqigong practice, because we really need that to develop our diagnostic and other awareness, forms of awareness, for developing our body. And you see here in the Ming Dynasty already how important it is, because the luminosity from Shunling is basically what facilitates the integrations of our own mind with Ling substance or Ling Hun. The Ling counts as a motivator for the decision-making process in a person. Your mind reaches as a result of Ling Shun practice, either with or without connection with everything. And the Shunling practice has to help you facilitate linking with everything. The thing is also that the Chu Emperor, because of Shunling practice, thought he was infallible, because as a result of that he had an intuitive grasp of the relationships between things. But it is not true. Meditation doesn't help you to become infallible, to become perfect, or that your intuition is always correct and that there is no error in your judgment. There's going to be judgment errors in everything that you do, always, your whole life, no matter what you practice as a spiritual person. And the modesty that Taoism emphasizes, and that's different from Chu, is also to recognize that modesty helps you to be prepared for the errors that you make. Chu combined all kind of teachings from different schools, and this combination we call syncretism. And I have to make a little bit of a remark about that, because syncretism is interesting because it looks at what binds different religions with each other, and it's very close to the universalism that I always agitate against. Universalism takes things, all things spiritual, as the same. And syncretism just looks at what binds things as the same, and it says this is then the most important part. It also appreciates the differences between religions, because they have their own different goals and stuff like this. So this is interesting, but syncretism is essential for the Ming Dynasty. And the idea of syncretism, especially in relationship to the religion, was already much older than that. And already in the Han Dynasty, you see that there is this tendency sometimes about syncretism in Chinese culture. So maybe we can call China a syncretic culture. I mean, they also adopted Hegel very easily and Karl Marx. So these are also used in a particular kind of way, which is also pretty much syncretic. So I think, yeah. But anyway, the exclusivity of the different religions, this is what he wanted to do away with. He wanted to use the what binds the different religions together to shape his empire, to shape his country, and to shape the rules and the regulations for the people. This is basically what he did. And for his position, the syncretism is very understandable, because he had to deal with all these different kind of religions and ideas, and as a result of that, he had to satisfy a lot of people to make sure that they do not become rebels, like, you know, the kind of rebels that he also originated from, and that he wouldn't create his own resistance in the way how somebody like Machiavelli advises emperors and kings to create their own resistance, so that they always know who is plotting against them. And as far as I know, this is not necessarily what he did. And in Wudang culture, when I went to Wudang and I became a Taoist in 2000, and I became a disciple of Yaoxuan De, Sifu Yaoxuan De, Taoist, at that moment still Taoist Sifu Yaoxuan De, then I was rubbed in by everybody that, you know, you first had to study Confucianism, and only after that you can study Taoism. Because without understanding Confucianism, Taoism is incomprehensible. What we do in the West, we translate and then we take our Taoist ideas from the translations, and the translations very often are literally, figuratively, philosophically, ethically, and aesthetically not in accord with the original text. And the original text is really very complicated language, because every sentence have only four characters, and there is no such things as bendings of time or gender or direction or anything like that. You know, you have to make that up from the text, basically. So there is this oral tradition of translating the Tao Te Ching, and there are several traditions of the Tao Te Ching use. And in Taoism, the Tao Te Ching is important, but it is not that important, because there's also all kind of other texts that explain how reality works, and the Tao Te Ching is one of the things that explains Tao. And for Westerners, they are like, but the Tao Te Ching is the root of everything. And although it's the root, or in Cheng Yi, there was all kind of developments and revelations that changed the idea of Taoism a lot. And that did lead eventually to the what we call the Taoist religion, who saw themselves as an alternative for the state in many cases. So they saw themselves as a heavenly kingdom to be founded. And Cheng Yi especially, they did that, but the White Lotus and the Red Turbans and all kind of other groups, the Five Packs of Rice and the Yellow Turbans, they all saw themselves as replacements for the dynasties they lived in, because they saw the moral decay of the dynasty and they wanted to create a perfect society. And our next topic, when we talk about the apocalypse, will involve these kind of things. Anyway, but what we take from this also in medicine is that in respect to Taoism, Chu actually had was in two minds. One is that he really enjoyed Taoist thoughts and religion and spirituality. He had a lot of Taoist advisors that helped him to understand Taoist texts and other religions. And at the moment when he did that, he also decided that he didn't really particularly like immortality cults, because he saw them as something outside of Taoism, and Taoism itself sees them also as a little bit different. And I noticed that in the Wudang Mountains is that the majority of Taoists who live there, they practice some form of Tai Chi Chuan as part of their health regimen and personal hygiene But they don't practice it to the point where they actually want to become an immortal, but in something like the Shen Wu Pai and probably some other cults in Wudang Taoism that are following the teachings of Zhang Zhangfen. There are people who go further than that, like me, also myself. I think, like, okay, somebody predicted me that I would become like 1,076 years old, and it's worth trying even if I wouldn't succeed, because it gives meaning to my life. So the immortalism also gives meaning. But to realize immortality in society with children while teaching, being vulnerable to all kind of things that happen in a society, media and so on and so on, it is very unlikely to ever get to that. The other hand, he also saw immortality cults as a necessity. So he didn't forbid immortality cult. He was very good in forbidding things, like he forbid the Red Turban cult that he was originally a member from, and so on, because he didn't want to have anything competing with his view. So he created basically new views, and he absorbed their teachings in his new views. He replied to this idea on the criticism of an agnostic Confucian called Han Yu, from a little bit before his time, or during his time. And Chu didn't think that immortals were good in governing people. So for him, this was the baseline of everything, of ghosts, spirits, and so on and so forth. If it helped him to create good governance, then everything was okay. But if it didn't, he was not into it. And what he thought is that if you would eradicate immortals, so you would kill them all, then also the belief in ghosts and spirits and so on would disappear with people. And you need ghosts and spirits to create a particular level of fear in society that is irrational, to make sure that you can govern people. And this made it necessary to allow immortalism, even though he wasn't a big fan. So considering everything, you can see, okay, he came from a grandfather who was a shaman. He gave him a worldview about ghosts, spirits, shamans, xian, and so forth and so forth. And at the same time, he had some reservations, and he built policy structures where he actually not only created an empire for the world, but he also created an empire for heaven. And he saw himself in a very serious way, in a very spiritual way, the lens through which he had to interpret the will of heaven to rule society well. As a whole, I think Chu Emperor, the first Ming Dynasty Emperor, was a mixture of ambition but also integrity that he struggled with to bring them together and to make sure that everything went all right. As a whole, he said that the dark realms of heaven and earth are part of his empire. And that is very interesting. And that is the part that is currently missing in the Wudang Taoist culture. Because Taoists, they are following the prescriptions of the Chinese government. And the Wudang Pai people, they mostly focus on the Kung Fu and the sports and the business part. And as a result of that, they are willing to involve themselves in Western spiritual ideas. I've seen people, you know, charging swords with magnetism and stuff like this. And these kind of things, they are originating in the West. They are not part of Chinese culture, because there's no such thing as, you know, being able to charge a sword with qi from yourself. But by wielding the sword every time, you know, it gets charged with you as an extension of you. And that is part of the more shamanic aspects of Taoism that Chu actually was emphasizing. So what we talk about here is that divinity of reality, pantheistic, animistic reality, was what moved the Chu Emperor. And that is the main theme of the founding of the empire. Is on the one hand the military conquest, the political choices on how to name things and how to organize things, the compassion to make sure that everything is well organized so that people have the largest level of well-being, and that economics is not the most important part insofar as the empire is concerned, although you can tax people for these kind of things. But the most important part is that the people are satisfied so that they do not rebel against the empire, that they do not complain, they don't have strange ideas, and so on and so forth. And that there is this continuous involvement with the supernatural divinities and so on and so forth to make sure that you are continuously involved in this moral process of making the right choices. And this is where is the power of religion and spirituality, is that religion and spirituality is not a form of vampirizing, and it is not necessarily opium for the people, but it is also a way to find your own moral compass. And as a result, I think, not considering the cruelty of running an empire, I think as a whole, from what you read about his life and the success of his life and how it influenced later generation and especially the Wurangpai, I think it succeeded to a large degree to be a compassionate and humane form of governance, even though he saw himself as a absolute ruler who controlled everything. He was in that sense just a dictator. He didn't even prefer to have too many advisors, as you saw from the previous video. And as a result of that, we see that political reality and his spiritual reality were pretty much harmonized. And because of this harmonization, he was able to establish his dynasty. And in the next stories, we're going to see in how far his descendants are rooted back into the ancestry of the family, like his grandfather, his father, and himself, because he was of course also a legendary person after that, to maintain the well-being of the country and of course also the dynasty itself. Okay, I hope you really enjoyed this video. Insofar as you show this to other people, help them convince themselves that they should support the channel, even if it's only for $3 per month. They have access to movies like this, and they can enjoy things like this, and they can always upgrade in a later date to a higher level to partake in classes where everybody is always welcome, of course, also to test basically the ideas that I show in the different movies. Don't forget to like and to make sure that there is comments under the Patreon page address. Here. Already for a while I am considering making a video about the philosophy at the basis of the Wudang, Kung Fu and Taoist schools. The reason for that is because I'm writing a book about this subject, and there is a lot of topics in there that are very hard to tackle without continuously doing additional research to complete a picture. As you know, I am a Wudang Taoist, and already for a long time. I think my first study started over 35 years ago, and I became officially a monk registered in the Wudang Mountains in 2000s, maybe 1999. Anyway, the first time I came to China for that purpose was in 1999. And I did do some research, of course, before I started that, to see where I would end up with and what I would end up with. And I noticed that for people who go there, usually focus on the Wudang martial arts. And sometimes they focus also a bit on the Taoist things, but the martial arts is basically the core thing. And philosophically, they basically lean towards whatever their teacher says. And sometimes they read something, but Western sources are sketchy on Wudang Taoism, so people mix up things. I've even seen websites that basically repeat Western Christian things almost purely, or Buddhist things, or Shaolin things, or, you know, they just mix up all kind of stuff. Because there are too many uncertainties about the backgrounds of what they're actually studying.